What's your name? I condensed in the last 7 minutes while ago. I condensed about an hour and 40 minutes of preaching.
Woo! That's pretty good.
Some of y'all probably knew nothing about that story about the fish god Dagon and the city of Nineveh. The city of Nineveh was a very, very wicked city. They were a very aggressive people, somewhat violent people. And Jonah probably knew enough about them to know he really did not want to minister to them. And Jonah's relationship with God, after the fish part of the story, after the great fish and after he got vomited out, tells a lot about Jonah. And Jonah probably had some personality issues. Do any of you have some personality issues that you would like to share at this time? Some of you have some that I would like to talk about. You know, there are some things hidden in Scripture that we don't discuss openly that I just kind of want to touch on. Elijah was one of the most powerful prophets ever. Absolutely one of the most powerful prophets that ever ministered. And I think he suffered from depression. He said, I'm the only one. Nobody else is doing this but me. And I'm going to die alone out here in this wilderness. And God had to tell him he had another team. 7,000 that haven't bowed a knee. There were people in the house of Ahab and Jezebel that were hiding prophets and feeding them. Do you realize that if you're hiding 1,000 or more people, you got to feed them 2 or 3 times a day? Where'd they get that food? Who cooked it? Where did they hide them, and how far did they have to transport it? Amen?
Yeah.
And how did all that go on and Elijah know nothing about it? The Apostle Paul said, for me to live is Christ, but for me to die is gain. Did you know it's against the law in 50 of the United States for you to say, I'm going to kill myself?
Wow.
It's against the law for you to say that. If you say that, I can have you arrested because you said it. I don't even have to know who you are. You cannot say, I'm going to kill myself. It's unnatural. The Bible proves it's unnatural. No man hath at any time hated his own flesh. That's right. So if you hate yourself, you probably hate somebody else too. Just throwing that out. Well, I'm getting pretty close to some of the personality issues. I kind of wanted to touch the topic here. Jonah had some issues. And he had a powerful word from God. That destruction is coming to this city if you don't repent. Now, if you have a testimony, big if you have a testimony, you have the ability to lead someone else to the repentance that you know about.
All right. Amen.
Yeah.
If you have a testimony, you have the capacity to lead someone else to that place of conversion. But Jonah had some issues in his spirit. And I'm going to just spontaneously I'm going to bring Lisa up here for a few minutes. Clock's right there, Lisa, so you have to watch the clock. You didn't know I was going to do this at all, did you? I'm going to bring Lisa up here for just a few minutes because in the story of, and in case you didn't have any outline at all, what we're doing in this second session is we're finding out reasons not to tell our story and a first look at your story. And here's why we want to take a first look at your story. Your testimony is going to change. That's like what I covered with Joseph. Whatever your testimony is, your testimony's going to change. You're going to have experiences in your life that are going to change your testimony. And in Jonah's story, he got in the belly of that great fish, and Holy Scripture says his soul fainted. His soul fainted. You remember what happened to Adam and Eve when God breathed the breath of life into them? God breathed the breath of life into Adam, and he became a living soul. It is said of Jonah that his soul fainted. I think the breath went out of him. I think he went into a coma. I haven't read this anywhere. I may write it somewhere one day. I think he went into a coma. I think he was in sort of a soul sleep. And while he was out, God did the supernatural.
Yeah.
Amen. If you get to a place that your soul faints, where are you going to turn? After you tell God, I'm not going to do it that way. I'm going to do it the way I want to do it. And your soul faints. I want Lisa to come up here. And she's going to talk to you a little bit about how well God can work with vomit. Hey.
He didn't ask me to do this. I would have been really prepared. That's one probably why he didn't say that he was going to give this to me. I'm not my husband. One of my main places when I received healing in my body and restoration to my soul back in probably 1990, I was raised on a pew just like Daniel was, and you know, we pretty much, Daniel says he's got at his dad's church that he had teeth marks from gnawing on the pew where he'd sit on the end of his mom's knees and she'd bounce him. And he'd be on the pew. I wasn't quite that young when I remember mother going back to church. But I was raised on a pew. Everything we did was church, church, church. It was our life. And I enjoyed it. I loved it. That's all I knew was church. But there was a time in my life that after I married, and I married at a very young age, I went away. Didn't serve God for over 18 years. But when I tell my testimony, at that particular time, when the Lord restored me back to, and he restored me, but he made me a brand new person, you know.
Amen.
Gave me beauty for ashes. I mean, I was a new person inside. And I was so wanted to tell my testimony. Because I really did have one. I had a big testimony. I had names in my testimony that everybody wanted to hear. They wanted to hear the scoop. Because you could read about some of it in the line at the grocery store. And they wanted to hear that. But God began to restore me in such a way and give me newness. And I formed a relationship with God which I had never heard in my life. Sitting on a pew, hearing the truth preached to me, but never in the form of having a true relationship with Jesus Christ.
Right.
I thought my pastor had a relationship. Maybe it was just me and the way I interpreted all that, but I didn't realize that I can truly have this one-on-one relationship with Jesus. But let me tell you what. I used Jonah and the story of Jonah. And when I read about him being vomited, nobody likes to hear that word. My daughter-in-law said that on TV one time, and it just about, she's on the Ellen Show. My daughter-in-law's Kelly Clarkson, and she said that word because she had had such horrible, horrible pregnancies, and she said that word, and Ellen was like, she said that. But the word vomit, I'm telling you, there's nothing pretty about it, but God used vomit to restore. And I'm sure that when Jonah came out with the sea, we all know what that word is made up of. And with everything out of that fish's belly, Jonah came up.
Mm-hmm.
Seaweed wrapped around his neck and his body, and the slime and the sludge from all that that fish had in him. And God said, now get up.
Amen.
Because what I said in the beginning, you still need to do.
Yes.
And he was so willing to do it then. Don't we do that?
Yes.
Do
that? Come on now. That's
you
it.
Know, if, whether you've had a relationship with God and come back to him or not, we all think, it doesn't matter if the hair and makeup's on now. We've got seaweed around our neck and we're just willing to go. You know? But that's where I realized the true of what God had done in my life. Because believe me, the pit that I had fallen into was full of nothing but that kind of sludge and sin and hopelessness.
Mm-hmm.
I had no hope in my life.
Amen.
I thought that I had no way that I was going to be good for my children. I wasn't going to be good for anybody. I thought of ways. I knew if I took my life, you know, thank goodness I'd had teaching and upbringing and word that was hid in my heart.
Amen.
But those, the circumstances that he was referring to,
yes.
I couldn't get past the circumstances. And I kept thinking, well, if I did it this way, maybe it'd just appear as an accident. You know, that kind of thing. But I'm telling you, God renewed in me, and I wanted to live. And I wanted to share my testimony of the vomit that Jesus brought me out in.
Amen.
Come on. That's good.
Brought
good.
Me out in
uh-huh.
all of that. And you know what? It was a process. And you know what? Everybody you're going to talk to are, for the most part, in process.
Yeah. Right.
You know?
Yeah.
And circumstances. And process. And I began to go through process. Joseph, what was it? What did you say a while ago? 13 years? 13. You know, in different places in Scripture, you can find out where Paul went for.
Actually, it was 23 years. It was 17 to 40.
Okay.
23.
He's the math person. Okay. So, but even Paul, when his ministry, when he quit killing the Christians, you know, he went for years before he started doing great things. So there's process, but that doesn't mean that you don't have testimony. It means that your testimony changes.
Yeah.
So when I get up now and tell you my testimony, most of the time I don't even bring that up any bunch of that kind of stuff.
Right.
You know, sometimes I'm in the middle of what's going on in my life right now because I don't tell you. Me and Brother G over here has got a testimony right now since October.
Yes.
Amen.
Since a few months before October. We have a testimony, so your testimony is going to change. As you mature, faith to faith, as My pastor preached to us last week, faith to faith. You know, sometimes, you know, you need the milk. Mm-hmm. And then all of a sudden, the milk's not enough. You want meat.
Yeah.
So, in your testimony also, you know, it's not always just about what you're bringing out, you know, what you've been brought out of in the very beginning.
Right.
It's just like Pastor said a while ago, that you have to refine. You know, there's sometimes that there's, I need to witness to somebody, and there's just no way that I need to tell them everything about what God's done for me, unless we've got about 3 hours at my house. You know, let me put on a pot of coffee, and we're going to go back through all this. But there are times, there are people that you're going to have to do that with.
Right.
There's some that I need to share with them about what it is to go through divorce.
Right.
I mean, that's one of that's a huge thing in our world today. Go through divorce.
Yeah.
And a blended family.
Right.
And all there's different things about your testimony. But I'm gonna tell you something. You're gonna find yourself in a place where there's going to be somebody that needs to hear about the vomit.
Right. All right. All right.
Amen.
Yeah.
And you're gonna have to tell them. And you're gonna have to express all of that. And then we have to walk. Sometimes our testimonies are walk.
Mm-hmm.
If I always say this when I'm teaching a Sunday school class, a high school class more especially, edge walkers. You know, kids can understand edge walking. I had a daughter that was she always was just kind of edgy. She was edgy. She can go to YouTube. She just always wanted to, she to this very day, she loves to watch scary movies, all that kind of stuff. She wanted to watch the things that would just keep her like this, on the edge. But she would like to jump off of, like, bridges, you know, and you know, do stuff like that. Cliffs and things like that. She just like edgy stuff. But you have your edge walkers. You have people, I put a piece of tape right down in the middle of a Sunday school class, and I'd have the highest heels I could have on, and I was just doing the edge walking thing, and I would just be like this, and I would try to not get off the tape. And I had the highest heels on, and you know, you're not doing one thing wrong.
Right.
You know, not one thing wrong. And all of a sudden, you didn't mean to, but you failed. But the reason why you failed was because you were on the edge.
Yes. Right.
You know? And you know, people, there are people in life that go down paths and their lives end up in a situation that they never intended to be there.
Right.
Come on.
Yeah.
You didn't intend to be there, or they didn't intend to be there. But God's going to let you slip right into their life because they fall. And they need somebody to help them back up off and learn to get away from the edge. And you're going to be able to help people like that. But stay away from the edge and keep your testimony clean. And the way you walk, that's where I was going. I got on a rabbit trail there. When you walk, when you're in the workplace, you've got something to share.
Amen.
You walk with their smile on your face and the glow of Jesus in your life on your face. And you have a responsibility to carry a light unto the world. And even though you're experiencing some of the little roads that Joseph had to go down, and you know, you've been imprisoned, you know, now, and things are not going as you should, you still have the dream that you've got to hold on to.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen?
You have the dream. And even though you've been vomited up sometimes, the walk that you're doing every day in the workplace is your testimony.
Yeah.
And then your life, and somebody will come to you and they'll say, what is it about you? Tell me why you're always... So why have you always got this glow about you? Your life, with Jesus in it, may not always be perfect. But you've got a testimony.
Yeah.
And you've got a responsibility to uphold that. And when they talk to you and you get into a one-on-one situation with them, then that might be time to tell them about the seaweed that's been wrapped around your neck and what the Lord, and I'll tell you what, before you know it, while you're testifying to them and telling them the things that, God has done in your life, you haven't even told them about the situation that you're going through right now. And before you know it, you just testified to yourself.
Yeah.
I am a person that likes to journal. I will encourage you to do that. My husband, he does not like to journal. He's a prophet. And sometimes his journal gets dark.
Sometimes his journal gets dark.
And sometimes he's in the cave with Elijah. And he's thinking, nobody's hearing me, you know. But I love to journal. And I'll tell you what, I love to journal. I like to start my journal on January the 1st of a year. And I'll journal all the way through the year. And then the next New Year's Eve or New Year's Day, I'll sit down and I'll read that journal from January to January. And I'm going to tell you what, God, you can have a whole new testimony by then.
Yeah.
You can update your testimony.
That's true. That's true.
That's good.
Because God, in the smallest little things, in the darkest moments of any week that you think, it happened to me this past week, it doesn't mean I have all the answers that I want. And they're not the way I would want God to answer some of them sometimes. But it is definitely God.
Amen.
And if I journal something and I say something, and it's like, I don't know what we're going to do, blah, 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 blah. And then a couple of pages over, I write something else again. And if you're not careful, you don't even remember, you don't even keep up with the fact that what happened to you 2 days later was an answer to what you were feeling the day before. It is truly an answer to prayer. And the little tiny bitty things that will go past us that is absolutely totally miraculous, if you don't keep up with them sometimes, because God is just that good.
Yeah.
He'll slip things in on you and he'll totally, you'll forget about it. But I'm telling you, I have been in the belly of the whale. I truly believe that my situation, modern day, but it couldn't have, I don't believe that it can, I think I might have been just grateful to have been in the belly of the well, because the thought of being thrown overboard and out in the middle of a sea, that just totally freaks me out. And then that it got all calm for everybody else. And knowing that I had disobeyed God. And in that, see, here's me. I'd be going, oh, I'm not worthy of. And then he sends the big fish and swallows up Jonah. And I think myself that there was a lot of soul searching going on.
Yeah.
I know that in that part of my life, I thought, how can I now go back to what I never was untoward God. Always wanted to live for God, but I was told that that my former husband didn't want any part of that, wouldn't live with me, and I knew that. But guess what? He didn't anyway. And I realized that I had sold out my God for things that I don't have anymore. And I thought there was no way out. How can I do this? And I mean, it was just dark, 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 dark. I had battled depression. I had been in hospitals for that. And I couldn't change my situation. I could not change my situation. I could not stand it anymore. I, because that's all there was, because there was no God that I let in my life. I believed that his hand was on me all along. Because I know of situations that he could have just taken me at any time. But he kept his hand on me. The seed was planted in my heart. And when I did reach out and call out to God, with the seaweed choking me, trying to take the life of me, and my soul fainted within me, is when I cried my hardest and said, God, my God, I know you're real. Forgive me. And I want you to know that when you see me worship in a church today, I worship just like he had done it yesterday.
Yes.
Because it's that real to me today.
That was a part of her testimony that involved people and things and hurt. Anybody been hurt?
Yes, sir.
More than once?
Yes, sir.
Involves hurt, and those things get really big, and God gives you peace where you had such hurt. And so that becomes a big part of your testimony. But time resolves a lot of those things, and a few years later, you're giving your testimony, and those names never even come up.
That's right.
Because God's done some greater things.
Amen.
And some bigger things.
Yes.
And he's proved himself so powerful in ways that you never thought that he would.
Right.
It's not because you're not being honest. It's because other things become so much more important.
Yeah.
Amen? Now, for 9 years, I was an ENT, and as an ENT, you learn a lot of facts and a lot of material, and you get tested like in continuing education and whatnot. And in that industry, excuse me, a lot of people that test very well will do really good on their written exams, and they know the material. But in that field, you have practical exams, and nowadays with the National Registry, you're actually tested by people from the state. And they come and they give a practical test. And a high percentage of people that do well on the written tests fail the practical application. And if we're not careful here today, I say that allegorically, this is the segue. If we're not careful here today, we're going to learn how to witness and still not be able to do it because you can't make a practical application. And there are reasons why we don't witness. There are reasons why we don't give our testimony. We don't want to say the names. There are reasons why we don't give our testimony. Well, I'm going to really be able to do a lot more for Jesus when I lose the 60 pounds I need to lose. You know, I'm going to do a lot more for Jesus when I own my own place. Because that's where my faith is. I'm going to...
Come on.
You know, I'm going to... We have a mutual friend, an old friend. Her name is Brenda Como. She's from Leesville, Louisiana. And she went to Texas Bible College. And while she was in Texas Bible College, this was years ago, the kids were sitting around talking about their testimonies, you know. And some of the Bible school students were saying, well, you know, I used to do drugs, and we'd do this and that, and that. They'd share a little bit of their testimony. You know, we used to go out in high school and get drunk, and Brenda's last name was Como, C-O-M-E-A-U-X. And they were all saying what they used to do when they were in high school, what they were doing before they got into Bible school, and what they were doing before they served God. And Brenda was in this group of students, and she said, well, before I received the Holy Ghost, I was French. She was just a Pentecostal kid raised in an almost all Pentecostal town, and she didn't have any wild stories to tell. She was just French. You know, why don't you testify? Why don't you have a testimony? Why can't we tell what we need to tell? There are a number of things that hinder us. One thing that I'm going to throw out here, I'm going to make some practical applications. I'm going to talk to you. I'm going to talk about you. And I'm going to make you uncomfortable. But we got to get this story out.
Yeah.
Inside of you is a story that needs to be told.
Yes.
And we need to pull it out of you. Okay? The psalmist David said, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O God. Amen?
Yeah.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. When things come out of you consistently that are not acceptable, if any situation arises that involves emotional intent or purpose, you have to go beyond what is normal so people can understand what you're trying to express. I mean, if the most endearing phrase that you have for your beautiful bride is wide track. And you're upset. And you're angry. And you have some things to say that are not pleasant. If you always address her as wide track, what are you going to say to her?
I don't know.
To express how upset you are. And go beyond wide track.
Oh, wow. Okay.
If wide track is normal, you're already in a pit.
Come on.
Yeah.
And if your emotions are negative, it's fixing to get nasty.
Yeah. Right.
Let's go spiritual now. If your words are not acceptable, and the meditations of your heart are not acceptable, and the time is perfect to share your testimony, where are you going to go with the precious blood of the Lamb?
Oh, wow.
In a situation that you've created,
yeah.
Oh, wow.
That is not good.
Oh, man.
I'm just going to throw this out here. Sometimes we don't testify because we don't feel like our testimony conforms with the way we live every day.
Oh, there you go.
So be careful.
Amen. All right.
Be careful. Now, y'all know how you were raised. You know your influences. I got my mouth washed out with soap when I was 5 years old. The math is pretty easy. That was 57 years ago. I remember it very well. Can't see through a screen door when the sun's bright outside. You can't see through a screen door. So I had my nose mashed against the screen door. It was Sunday afternoon at Christmas time in Killeen, Texas. Everybody took their Christmas trees to the fire station. They lined them up 20 feet wide, probably 10 feet tall, and 100 feet long. Everybody's Christmas tree in town on Sunday afternoon, they set them suckers on fire, and it was something to behold. Excuse me. And they were fixing to set them on fire, and I wanted to watch it, and my dad had a preacher friend at the house, and he didn't want, the fire station wasn't 3 blocks away. He didn't want to load up and leave the preacher friend there, so I stuck my nose up against that screen door where I could see inside the living room, and I said, "Darn it, Daddy, come on." You didn't say darn it at the parsonage. I got my mouth washed out with soap for saying darn it. Now I'm going to tell you something right now. Keep your conversation clean.
All right.
Especially if you have a testimony.
If you have a testimony, yes.
If you have a testimony, you keep your conversation clean. Because there's going to be some good things coming out of your mouth that need to coincide with what is normal for
all
you.
All right, all right.
Amen. What is normal for you. Can I keep meddling?
Go ahead.
Are y'all apostolic enough to know the difference between preaching and meddling? Well, a few minutes ago, I started meddling. Now, I'm well knee-deep into your stuff now. If you have experienced divorce, there is an element of the commandments, the 10 commandments, that you have to be very carefully aware of, or you're going to kill your children.
That's right. This is right.
You're going to kill your children.
This is right.
Whether they're babies
or adults. Go ahead.
Honor thy father and mother. The only commandment.
With promise.
With promise. Honor thy father and mother, and long will be the days of your life. If you've experienced divorce, and your children have constantly heard you degrade their other parent, your children are dying. You're killing them. If you don't pray, it's going to be difficult for you to witness.
Come on.
From my perspective. And here's why. People think that the Bible says, whatsoever you pray when you desire, believe that you receive it and you shall have it. Did y'all hear me say that? Whatsoever you pray when you desire, believe that you receive it and you shall have it. That's not what it says.
No, sir.
It's not what you pray when you desire something. It's whatsoever you desire when you pray.
Yes.
Praying is the thing.
Right.
Praying is the thing. And when you find yourself in prayer, whatsoever you desire, believe
right, that
you'll receive it.
Amen.
And you shall have it.
Right.
And how many of you have people that just kind of dump on you sometimes? Mm-hmm. You know, they just, just unloved. Sometimes a lot of good meals are messed up by waitresses and waiters that want to share way too much with you. You know? But if you pray already, now if you pray and somebody starts sharing something with you about the circumstances in their life, you can say, we are prayers. And if you don't mind, we'd like to pray for you about that. Would you mind if we, what is your mother's name? Yeah, what is your mother's name? Can we pray for your mom? And when you start doing that to people, they know, now I lay me down to sleep. Pray the Lord my soul to keep. I should die before I wake. Pray the Lord my soul to take. But a lot of people don't know very many folks that really pray.
Right.
And when you're a prayer,
come on,
and you'll let people know, that you will talk to God about them. Mm-hmm. You've opened a door to testimony and witness. Yes. And we'll continue this after lunch. I believe in releasing the power of healing. Amen. And I believe in releasing the power of deliverance. Even in this setting right here.
Yes, sir.
Even in this setting right here. So let's just believe that the presence of God can heal and set us free while we're here.
Amen. Amen.
You say, well, I don't know what you're talking about. I'm talking about high blood pressure and sugar diabetes.
Yeah. Come on. Hallelujah. Yes.
You say, no, I thought you were talking about a headache. No, I'm talking about diseases.
Yeah.
Amen. I'm talking about bad choices.
Yeah.
I'm talking about God touching our lives and turning things around for us.
Yeah.
Amen. So, I'm talking about being supernaturally delivered from depression.
Yeah. Amen.
Right here in this session today.
Yes.
Come on.
Change my words.
In Jesus' name.
Change the way I think.
Yes.
Let the meditation.
Meditation.
Of my heart.
Of my heart.
That's what the psalmist said.
Yes.
Let the meditation of my heart.
Yeah.
Let the meditation of my heart.
Right.
Let the meditation of my heart be acceptable. Amen.
Yes.
Amen. Yes. There's things we can't say. I'd like to go past darn it, but we're going to put this thing on the internet, so I'm going to keep it really, really clean. Until I knew we were going to video, I was going to really do some teaching here today. Some practical application. Some practical application. But I want to tell you something. If you don't watch what comes out of your mouth, I might have to look at all of you because I'm looking at some of you. If you don't watch what's coming out of your mouth, your testimony is not going to work.
Amen. All right.
Because you can't talk about God condemning something one moment.
All right.
And God saving something the next moment with the same tongue.
Uh-oh.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O God, so my testimony can be delivered.
All right.
Woo!